Hello, YouTube. This is Jesse Ferguson, Canadian folk singer and YouTuber here since 2007. And today I'm bringing you a quick video on how to choose and how to use guitar picks. Common types, how to go about choosing the right kind for you, and so on. So, to begin with, I've got here a collection of various picks that I've collected over the years, various types, and so whenever you're just starting out with guitar, usually you'll buy some kind of kit, or maybe buy an inexpensive guitar at the music shop, and usually what you'll end up with is a few inexpensive picks that they throw in with the deal. And usually they'll be light or medium picks, often with the logo of the music store on the front. Now this one happens to be a Fender one, but that's a good representation of the kind that you tend to get for free when you buy a guitar. Now usually those picks are not of super high quality. They tend to be slick picks that break down fairly quickly. So it's a good idea when you pick up your guitar, or even at this point if you're not happy with the picks that you have, is to just go into the music shop and buy a few random picks of various kinds from various makers and various thicknesses. So what you want is to find the right kind of thickness for you and the right size and shape. Now they come in a variety of sizes. This one has a loop for attachment to your thumb. Now I'm right-handed, so I would put that on this way. And that holds it on your thumb, so that may appeal to you. Personally, I don't like that kind because depending on the songs that I'm playing, if I'm doing a flat picking song or a strumming song, I tend to hold the pick in a different way. So this sort of limits you to holding in one way. Now this brand is Herco, so if that's of interest to you, that's all right. Now one thing that it does have that I like are these holes in the back, which allow you to get a bit more grip on the pick. So that leads me to, three basic parameters here. You have what it's made out of, which most of them are made out of nylon. So that's a pretty much a standard material. So it may not say nylon on the package, but that's probably what it's made out of. You can also buy picks made out of brass or other materials. I don't generally recommend those. If you have a very good reason for trying a different kind of material, then go ahead. But most people will be satisfied with some kind of nylon. So that's parameter one, what's it made out of. Number two would be the size of the pick. Now, as you'll see, this is a sort of micro pick, a sort of stubby, some people call them jazz picks. I used to play these for my mandolin. I never used a pick this small, and I'll show you a basic sort of standard size beside it for comparison. So as you can see, it's quite a bit smaller. I used to play these stubby picks with my mandolin, thinking that it would give me greater precision. But I've since graduated to just using a standard size pick for mandolins, I can use the same pick on my guitar as on the mandolin, which has its advantages in terms of not having to have two separate kinds of picks. So here are those tiny little ones. You can try them out. They look pretty. These ones are made by Jim Dunlop, USA. You'll notice I put a sticker on this one because these clear ones were a real pain if you dropped them somewhere or in the bottom of your gig bag to find them because they're clear. So note to self, color doesn't really matter too much. You can get fancy images on your picks, but they tend to wear off almost within a week or two. So don't bother spending extra money to get guitar picks that have, say, a picture of the Beatles on the front or something like that, because those will wear off almost immediately if you play as much as I do. So black picks and clear picks, not the best choice, because these black ones are hard to find in the bottom of your gig bag, or if you drop them on the floor in a dark bar when you're playing or something like that. So bright colors, if you can find them, go with a bright color. So that's size. Now, you'll notice too that there are some that are rounded on the tip. The tip is rounded. Or ones that are sharp. I tend to prefer the sharp ones because they give me greater precision when I'm trying to do flat picking. So in other words, picking out individual notes rather than strumming the whole thing. Now eventually, as the pick wears, it's going to end up looking rounded like that anyway. And I mean, a pick is worth about 30 to 50 cents, so you might as well replace them if this is what you want. Sharp, and it ends up rounded through use, which it will. It will wear out. So those are some parameters, so that's the pointiness of it. You can also find some sort of novelty type picks, like this one looks like a shark spin. In my mind, you're better off just sticking with standard picks. This shape is more of a novelty than anything else. I think I have another one in that same style in gray somewhere. Yes. I think they're made by, it's called Fins. Looks like a shark's fin. Again, just more of a novelty. Again, this is made by Jim Dunlop. All of the picks I've got from the Jim Dunlop lineup have been fairly good. So, that size, shape, pointiness, material is pretty much a standard. They're mostly going to be nylon. Now, the biggest thing I can recommend to you is get some picks that have some texturing on them. Now, it may be hard to pick that up on these here. There you go. I'll catch it in the light. You can see this is again made by, no, this one's made by George Dennis. But they're almost every line has some picks that have texture on them like that. And that makes a world of difference in terms of your control over the pick and not dropping them. I once lost a singing contest because I dropped my pick after it was an outdoor concert and I was sweating quite a bit. And the pick just slipped right out of my hand and it cost me the contest, I assume. Maybe it was my bad singing. But anyway, so here's one made by the company Brain, B-R-A-I-N. So this has some texture on there too. So these ones are much superior to any one that has no texture at all. See, here's one, like I was saying, one of those cheap music store ones from Steve's Music World in Ottawa. There's no texture at all. It's very slick. Any kind of sweat from playing or if you have, say, a sunscreen on your hands or lotion or something like that, you can forget about that staying put because you don't want to be having a death grip on your guitar pick. You want to have some flexibility there. You don't want to squeeze with all your worth because that'll decrease your sort of finesse. So in other words, find a pick that won't slip out of your fingers even if you have a light, loose grip on it. Now, what can you do with some of those picks that you do have that don't have texture on them? Well, one thing I do, and I have done, if I'm limited to a pick that has no texture, as you can see it there, is I take a knife or a push pin or something like that, and be careful with this, please. Use a cutting board so you don't cut yourself or the kitchen table. And you just do a few score lines and a cross pattern like that. And this will probably reduce the lifespan of your pick, but it'll make it a lot more usable. Again, you can see there. So just a few crisscross patterns with a knife, pressing fairly firmly down, and you end up with some texture. So those are some good ideas. Another just general tip is buy your picks in bulk. You can find packs usually at most music shops where you can get, you know, six to ten of them for, you know, $5, something like that. Don't just buy three picks because you will misplace them all the time. You'll be finding them all over in your jeans pockets, on the floor, under the couch, and so on. So buy lots of them, put a bunch of them in your guitar case so you won't run out. So those are the basic parameters. Now, as far as the stiffness goes, that's a very personal choice. When I started playing guitar, like I said, like most people, you got some free picks in the kit with your guitar. And usually they're mediums or lights. So what you want to do, though, is you want to think as you progress as a musician, as a guitarist, do I want to step up to something that's really heavy? So this one, they'll usually have a number on the back of a nylon pick. This one happens to be 1.30. Let's see if I can get that for you in the light. You can see there it's printed. And that is the thickness level in millimeters. So the thicker the pick, the heavier it is, assuming it's made out of the same material. So here's a 0.73, which I can bend easily. And here's a 1.3, almost double. And it barely bends at all. Now for a while I was playing really hard picks, and then I've since got out of that. And that's why I have so many hard picks here and not as many of the ones I currently play, because these ones are all just in storage. So it might be a good idea, too, if you decide to change your preferences and start playing a heavier pick or a softer one, don't throw out the old ones because, you know, in a year or two you may come back around. And there's always somebody out there, a guitarist, who shows up without a pick to play or something like that if you go to a jam session. So just hold on to the old ones. And those are the basic parameters. Size, shape, material, and thickness, and texture. So you want, usually it's a good idea to start with a medium pick, one with texture though, and then you can see if you want to go softer or harder. And it will only cost you $1 generally to buy one of each. a hard, a medium, and a soft. Again, Jim Dunlop is a good brand. These George Dennis are a good brand. And then that BRAIN, the Brain brand, are good ones because they have the texture. They seem to last well, too. I mean, depending on how much you use your picks, you'll get possibly, you know, a few years out of a single pick. So for 30 cents, it's not bad. You'll see they usually wear on one edge more than the other based on your right-handedness or left-handedness. So those are various picks that you can check out. Again, here's another type of small one. This one is a sort of hinged pick. It has a soft spot in the middle. Again, more of a gimmick than anything else. A couple of other just random tips associated with picks are, if you don't know this one already, you can keep a pick in your strings of your guitar. So you put it on under the high E, over the B, and under the G. And it sandwiches that in there, and you can never lose it. It won't fall out, especially if you have a textured pick. It'll just stay in there. So you always have a pick handy, no matter where you go. So rather than keep it in your case and you potentially lose it, or in your pocket. So that's just a good tip. Won't fall out. It doesn't do any damage to the strings that I've ever seen. So if you're using a metal pick, you might want to avoid that. Another good tip, which has saved me and other musicians on many an occasion, is put a hole, either with a knife. I even used a hole punch, one of those single hole punches, to put a hole through a standard pick and slide that onto your keys. Takes up almost no space, almost no weight, and you'll never be stuck without a pick ever again. And I've even been to concerts where a musician who was performing was dumb enough to show up without even an extra guitar pick, and so I lent him mine. So again, you can either just do it with a drill, or I use this one with the tip of my knife, my pocket knife, just drilled out a small hole. Don't do it too close to the edge, because then you'll risk it breaking off. And a great little saver if you happen to lose your pick. Or you show up to your buddy's house and he has a guitar but no pick for you to play. So that's just a good little tip. So, next thing I'm going to show you is how to actually hold the guitar pick while you're playing different types of music. Okay, we're back for part two. Now, if you're an absolute guitar beginner, you may wish to look at my full guitar introduction, my tutorial, Guitar Basics 101. So, that's a good one to check out if you're not familiar with the overall principles of guitar playing. Particularly for beginners. This one will just be a sort of supplement to that in terms of how to hold guitar picks. So, this is part that I've seen that in a lot of videos about guitar that I've seen, they don't really show clearly enough specifically how you hold the pick. They assume that you sort of know that by intuition or something like that. So, what you want to do is you hold your pick. I'll try to get this in front of this is a black pick again, the Brain brand. How do you hold it? Well, again, there are different ways to do this, but typically what I do is I form this kind of a shape with my hand. Try to get that to be a bit more contrast. So usually it's a relaxed posture. My wrist is fairly straight. It's not bent awkwardly like this or in some weird way. So just relax your wrist. You want a fairly relaxed hand when you're playing guitar, whether you're strumming or whether you're doing more elaborate picking. I guess doing flat picking, where it means you're just picking out individual notes, that's more of a rigid structure. I guess you're holding your hand more firmly that way because you need more precision to get certain notes. But generally, relax. You don't want to grip that like you're trying to hold on to an enemy or something like that, or your last dollar. You want a nice loose grip. Again, that's where the grip on your guitar pick comes in handy, because if you don't have any grip, then you're going to feel more inclined to pinch it harder. You don't want to. You want a nice relaxed grip. About how much of the pick should extend below your hand? Well, about that much, at least the way I do it. The tip, I usually point the tip of the pick, right, so you have the point here. I usually point that almost perpendicular, so right against the strings. Perpendicular like that. So if I'm holding it here, the point is pointing directly back at the sound, at the face of the guitar, or at the sound hole. You can either hold it back here, you can hold it back here, but usually you want that pick to be pointing straight down into the guitar. If anything, pointed back a little bit. So straight in or back. So
see if I can give you a visual on that a bit more. Again, this is going to be a somewhat artificial experiment because I'm playing it flat on my lap now, but it's usually like so, or back a bit towards the bridge. That's the best position to keep it in. Now, whatever you choose for that position, the angle of the tip, you're probably best to keep that somewhat consistent, because whenever you're doing any kind of picking where you have to pick out a bass note, say for instance of a chord, you don't want to have to be guessing, well, where's the tip of my pick? You want to know where it is by intuition, by the feel of your hands, not by having to look for it. So if it's flipping forward, flipping back the tip of your guitar pick, that's not a good thing. So if you're doing strumming, that's what you want. The other fingers aren't really doing anything involved in the pick. You should not have to involve any of the other fingers, or else you're probably squeezing too hard. Or your strumming technique is so wild or something like that that the pick needs more stabilization. You shouldn't need these fingers at all. Oftentimes they're I sort of brace my pinky and my ring finger against the pick guard, or the heel of my hand against the bridge. So these ones can move around independently. The pointer finger and the thumb are doing all the work. So you'll see there, just by looking at that, these two are bracing, and the palm of the hand is sometimes on the bridge, but it's all these two fingers that are doing the work for that complex kind of finger picking, flat picking, not finger picking. If you're just doing basic strums, it doesn't really change much. You're getting more motion with your wrist there and your forearm. But I'm not really holding the pick any more firmly. So that's about it. It's fairly simple to use your pick in that way. Again, don't clamp too hard. How much of the point should extend forward? Well, with a standard size pick, you probably want about a third to a quarter of the pick exposed, actually strumming. If you hold it too far back, like so, you're going to lose control. If you hold it up too close, you're going to choking up on the point. You're going to end up with scraping your knuckles, and you're going to end up with not very much pick there to do anything with. So, you know, somewhere of happy medium. About a third is what I expose, about like that. That's what it looks like from the other side. And again, there are different ways to skin a cat, but, you know, this is pretty standard to what I've seen most guitar players use. And it's loosey-goosey, not so loose that you're losing control, but you get a nice, crisp sound. Now, if you have a heavier pick, you're going to get more of a pick sound. Now, you might not be able to tell that, but if you're doing any kind of recording of your guitar, you can really pick up those little sounds, like your fingers sliding on the brass wound strings, if you're sliding up the neck. Also, I've had problems of tapping these fingers on the fingerboard, which I didn't notice until I started recording songs. And the same deal with your pick, so depending on how big a deal that is for you, you can modify how you hold your pick, and also what kind of pick you're using. Generally speaking, if you can, it's better, rather than pluck your picks down like this, is turn the pick a little bit. So turn it off axis a bit. So rather than coming down flat on the string like this, you turn it a little bit, and it makes less of a clacking sound on the next string as you go to the next string in your progression. So rather than flat like so, just a little bit of an angle down. So this is flat. This is a little angled. You can tell the difference in the sound there. So that's a good idea. I actually picked up that tip from a mandolin player named Chris Thiele, probably the best in the world right now. So that's it, basically. Again, if you want more instruction on guitar basics for absolute beginners, I do have a video which I'll post a link to. You can check out my website, www.jessefergusonmusic.com, to find out more about me and my different musical endeavors. And thanks for listening, and happy strumming.